Yes. Thank God. And every time I hear that song, I say, I don't think Mary knew all of that. And I guess that's why she kept asking Mary the question in the song. Mary, did you know? You know, God's Christmas, at the very core of Christmas, is love. And that's what I want to talk to you about. That's why we titled this, Because You're Loved. Now, God gave us Jesus. He sent Jesus. I want to talk about that. But God's gift to us was Jesus and giving us life. But our gift to God is how we live that life, what we do with that life, how God is able to have influence in that life. And so one of the things that I always, you know, I came into the kingdom of the church this way. I always wanted to know. I didn't want a whole bunch of facts and information and just be a sponge and a receptacle for information. I got enough information. I needed something that would change my life forever. And that's what I found. And so I often say, those of you that have been here, you know, I always say that the Bible never really started working in my life until I got this down. I'm still learning, but when I understood how much God loved me, it seemed to make everything else work. One of the reasons is because I felt like I had to be good enough, which I don't think that, you know, it was kind of like, you know, we used to shoot dice. Well, never mind. But you know, you come on. Come on. You know, you talk a little, you know, talk a little noise and say a few things that kind of make the dice turn over, you know. And but some people, my Christianity initially was like that, like, man, I hope today is my day. And then I found out how much God loved me, and I realized that's when this Bible started working. In 2 Thessalonians 2, it talks about how the Word of God works effectively in the lives of those who believe. So it's not just information. This is supposed to work. Yeah. I said, this is supposed to work. Yeah. And so when I found out how much God loved me, and then I found out how much God was for me, I'm like, shoot, what a combination. He loved me and he's for me. So I want to kind of capsulize all of that here today. I want you to go to 1 Peter chapter 5. And for the next few moments, I just want to give you what this is all about today. It's because we are loved. How many of you know that when love reaches out to you, something changes when you connect with it? And I said this morning, see, love is two ways. God's love is always on, but it takes the other side to connect with it. Then I had a song come to mind. I found love on a two-way street. And, you know, God's love is that way. It's he's always coming, but I need to make sure I'm on the same street. Okay, thank you. Yeah. Now, 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 7. How many of y'all know that song? How many of y'all know who sang that song? Who? No, it wasn't. It was a guy group, because, you know, we should do all them groups. It was a group. It was a male group, wasn't it? Yeah. She probably copied. Kind of like these Christmas songs. Everybody want to do Jingle Bell, the Christmas song. Can't nobody do it like Nat King Cole, though. Everybody else is a fake. Okay, let's get back to the message. The moment. It was the moment. I know my music. I found love on a two-way street. Lost it on a lonely highway. Oh, this is my church right here. Yeah. See, the first group didn't know it. See, this is, yeah. I need my people here. Okay, we can go on with the service now. Yeah. Merry Christmas. See, and that's what the joy to the world, you know. That's some joy.
in church. I ain't singing that song, though. Okay, let's go back to the scripture. 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 7. I'm reading out of Amplified. And I'm just going to get right in there. Casting the whole of your care. The whole of your care. All of your anxieties. All of your worries. All of your concerns. Once and for. In other words, don't pick it back up. For he cares for you affectionately. That means it's genuine, it's tender, it's at a heart level, but it's also at a feeling level. And he cares about you how? Watchfully. So now we're talking about God. So God's observing you attentively. He's like, I don't want you worried, concerned, anxious about anything. How do you know that, Pastor? Because he said, cast, bring all of your concern, all of your worries, all of your anxiety. Why? Because you're loved. I don't want you carrying all of that. I don't care what, and I'm going to just get right into it. It doesn't matter what's bothering you. It doesn't matter what's concerning you. God says, let me in on it. I didn't make you and create you to carry all of this. That's why your body will break down if you carry stuff too long. Certain things your body will break down. God said, bring it what? How much of it?
All.
What about for your children?
All.
What about for your finances?
All.
What about for your neighbor? You can't.
All.
Whatever is an anxiety. Well, it's an economy. We got a recession going on. Bring that. I'm not sure what's going to happen. You know, they're talking about all of this coming on this month, next month, or the next quarter. Bring all of that. Oh, God doesn't want you or me worried, concerned, or anxious. About what? He said, bring what? All of it. All of it. That's what love is all about. This is what Christmas is all about. We got a Savior now. And God doesn't want you and me having security, putting our security in anything else other than him. He wants to be a God to us. He wants to be Father to us. So he said, I don't want you worrying about anything. And that's all through the scripture. But I wanted to highlight the all part. Because if I don't know God loves me, I think he's just trying to play tricks on me. But because I'm loved, I'm like, okay, God, here I go. And see, if I know I'm loved, I can believe his promises.
Yeah.
I can trust him. If I know I'm loved, I can trust him. And God, I don't know how this is going. I don't know how this is going to shake out. I just don't know. But I trust you.
Amen.
But I trust you. I'm telling the group this morning, man, I don't know. I didn't know I can be like this. I'm in a place now, and it's been 7 months, a few months. Wow, God, this is so good. This is so good. Now I got all kind of battles and all kind of challenges and all the other stuff everybody else got. But I gave it. You know what cast means? I got it. Now you got it. And he said, leave it there. I'm not going to come back over there and get it because I don't want it. So when the devil brings it to my attention, I said, you got to go talk to him about that.
That's right.
Yeah. Hallelujah.
Don't you care? Yep. Okay. So because I'm loved. Now, David wrote this in Psalm 56. He says that God keeps a bottle. And in that bottle is every tear you've ever cried. Anybody ever cry from I'm a grown man. How many of y'all know grown men cry? How many of you ever cried? Nobody saw it but you. It's in God's bottle. And God said, I put it in the bottle. And David was, he was in captivity by some enemies at the time. And he was, the whole emphasis and essence of what he was talking about, Lord, God, remember these tears. Remember this. Because I know you're going to deliver me, but I know you remember these tears. I'm here to tell you today, y'all. And this is
so simple. But this at the heart of Christmas is I got somebody who loves me. And he concerned and cares about every minute detail of my life. He loves me totally, completely, and absolutely. He loves me. I'm never at a disadvantage. I don't ever have to wonder what is God for me or does he love me. It's settled forever. And I'm going to ask you today, if it hadn't been already, to settle this forever. And you'll never be at the mercy of another human being, another government, or anything else. God said, I will be a God to you, and the promises of God, he watches over his word to perform it. He said, my eyes are over you. My ears are open to your prayer. Just come to me. Just tag me in. I want relationship with you to the point that whatever you can't handle, I can handle. But at the same time, there's some stuff I want you to handle because I can only use you to touch so-and-so. I want to be able to use you, but I want you to be able to use me. Yeah. Love. He loves us. Now, I want you to look at, go to Luke chapter 12. This is really simple today, but I'm going to do everything I can to get you thinking about how much and because you're loved. And I'm going to get to it, but a lot of times we think we got to deserve something from God. That's not true. He loved me regardless of me. I'm so glad about it, boy, because I don't even like me sometimes. I'm glad God does not like me. Luke chapter 12, you there? Okay. Are not 5 sparrows sold for 2 copper coins? Copper coins. You know what that is? Pennies. 5 sparrows, those are birds, sold for 2 pennies. 2 pennies. And not one of them is forgotten by God. Did you hear what Jesus just said? Not one of them is forgotten by God. These little cheap birds sound like a Black Friday sale, doesn't it? 2 5 birds. 5 birds for 2 pennies. We would say worthless. But God, not forgotten by God. Listen to me. Listen to me. Worthless in our mind, birds. Yet God knows every time one, every time one falls. Sometimes in my house, I got a bird feeder, and I sit in the living room and watch them. And sometimes, and I got 10 on my window, so there's a reflection. So they think they're flying off into the sky. And they hit the window, bam! I'm like, what the heck was that? I go outside. God knew when they fell. Jesus said in Matthew chapter 6, not only does he know about them when they fall, he said he feeds them. So God sometimes moves on me to go to the store and get a bag of seed, to open the food, the container, dump the seed in there, and feed them. Not forgotten. Jesus said God has not forgotten any bird. He has not forgotten. How much value do you have? If he'll remember the bird that has no value to us, how much more will he not forget you? Okay, you got it. Just think about it. Man, that thing kept me up the other night. This little bird that has no value where we're concerned, it's important to God. Listen, there's nothing in your life that God misses. There's nothing in your life that's a small matter to God. Let's read the rest of it. Verse 7 says, "Now look, but the very hairs of your head are all numbered. Do not fear, therefore. You are more valuable than those birds."
So he takes it to a point. He said, I'm so into you, and I'm so intimate with you. I know you so much. This is why I can help you. I even know the numbers of the hair that's on your head. And if you don't have any hair, I know what that number is. Oh, I know what it was. I know what it was. That's how much God is into you. He knows everything, stuff you never told anybody that's still bothering you. Stuff that happened when you were 6 years old. That you still, stuff triggered that. He knows about that. That's how into you he is. He's intimate. That's why I can come to him and talk to him about anything. Why? Yeah. Only he wants me to. That's why he said, bring all your concern, all your care. I already know about him, and I got a way of escape. Amen. He said, you're much more valuable than these birds. The scripture tells us, don't think more highly of yourself than what? But you ought to think highly. So there's people that's going to come into your life. Some of us got them in our life right now, and they don't value us. We're disposable. Let's see, you got about, your shelf life is about 6 more months. Then they're done. I'm sorry. But he says, you are valuable. And don't you let somebody else that don't understand, because see, the manufacturer can set the value of something because they know what went in it. Yeah. Right? They know what went in it. So don't let people devalue you or cheapen you. Don't you, can I just talk to you? I'm just counseling you for a minute. Because this is part of the value. Because sometimes there are people we allow to be in our lives and have a strong place, and they don't even value us. They just there for what they can get out of us. And God is saying, no, you're more valuable than that. This is a word for somebody today. You're more valuable than the way that they're valuing you. And so when you value yourself, you won't give people a discount. You understand? There's something people are looking for and asking for. You're like, no, I'm more valuable than that. Don't treat me like that. I'm more valuable than that. Why? How do you know? God told me what my value was. God told me what my value was. And so I cannot allow myself to be cheapened. I know I cannot let my worth. I cannot allow somebody that has nothing to do, never created anything, to cause my self-worth to go down. So I want to remove my feet from a place where I've not been valued. Ha! And so he said, fear not. See, when you don't know what your value is, some stuff will, your fear will come in and try to dominate you just to stay in the place because somebody put a value on you and you say, well, I got to stay here because of this. Man, when you know who you are in Christ Jesus. He said, if God be for you, nobody can be against you. God is so into you, he'll cause you to leapfrog over a whole lot of things and people just because of who you are. As a man thinks, what? So is he. If you don't think you're valuable, you won't be. Yeah. So he says, see, and this is love. Because I'm loved, I know I'm valuable. You know, don't get me wrong, and I say this sometimes, and I know sometimes people take it the wrong way. I don't mean it any kind of way. I'm a nice guy. I'm very nice. But I don't give a rip. I found out. Okay, I probably should say it like that. But I found out how valuable I am. So somebody's opinion of me means nothing to me. Now I'm open to learn. I'm open to not constructive criticism, that's a misnomer. What did I call it? Anyway, I got a name, I changed it. But so I'm open to learn, but if somebody calls me out of my name, I don't answer. Why? Because I'm valuable. And I'm not fearful they're going to walk out. Whatever. Walk. No, because Because I'm valued. And if I'm not careful, I'll let somebody else's value they placed on me, I'll let that become bigger than what God said about me. Anyway, I just thought I'd mention that. So you're valued by God. You're a priority to God. Don't cheapen yourself for a dollar. Cheapen yourself for a relationship. They already got one half the foot out the door as soon as I'm done. Okay, keep it moving, Pastor. Okay, I want you. No, when you don't know your value, and God said, you're much more valuable than the bird, and I know all of that business. What I'm trying to get you to see, and what I'm trying to get you to understand, and what I'm trying to get you to walk in is, you don't have to spend one night. That scripture in Psalm 56, David, I think it's the Message Bible, said, every night you turned over for thinking about something you have to deal with. Say, God wrote that down in his ledger. God had a journal on you. Thank you, Lord. We don't have to worry. We don't have to be tight because we're loved. Okay, let me move on because I'm getting to the message now. First John 4. Thank you, Jesus. I remember, can I take you back just a minute? You know, I remember this guy told me, and you know, he was in the church before I was, so I figured he knew what he was talking about. We got to be careful what we tell people. But he said, man, you can never be a minister. I said, why? He said, all that stuff you did. I'm like, okay, I got a savior now. He said, yeah, but not that stuff you did. I said, so my stuff stink, huh? I mean, my stuff what? Jesus didn't die for that? Well, you can be saved, but you can't be no preacher. Are y'all glad I didn't listen? I think about that, and we have to watch what we tell people. The blood of Jesus is awesome. It's powerful. Okay. All right. 1 John 4. And it says, in this, the love of God was manifested. That means demonstrated. How many of you know love is what love does? I really know if you love me. I don't know after the song goes off. That God has sent his only begotten Son into the world that we may live through him in this love. And this is love. Not that we love God. So he's saying God didn't react to us loving him. Not that we love God, but that he loved us. And sent his Son to be the propitiation, that's a fancy word for sacrifice, for our sins. What I'm about to say now, it's the takeoff point in terms of walking with God and saints of God. This is what we need to let people know, because at least what I came out of and what I was into in terms of younger, long before I came to the knowledge of the word, is that God loved me when I was good. But this tells me God loved me long before I even thought about it. This tells me God didn't respond to me loving him. God loved me in spite of me. God didn't love me because of me, because of how good I was, how lovely I was. God loved me and you whether we were lovely or not, which we was not. God didn't love you because you decided, you know, see, if you were the holiest person in this room today, God loves you, right? But if you're the sorriest person in this room today, God loves you as much as he does the holiest one. You know why? Because God is love. And my action, what I do, it doesn't dictate whether God is going to, it doesn't affect his willingness to display his love, his power, his healing, everything.
That does not waver based on who I am and what I do. He loved me before I even knew about it.
Yeah.
So because I'm loved, that's why I can expect healing.
Yeah.
Because I'm loved, that's why I can expect stuff to happen when I pray. It's not because I'm that awesome man of God. It's because I got an awesome God that loves me. But I gotta get you to see this, that because a lot of people want to disqualify themselves or cheapen themselves because I made some mistake. We all made mistakes.
Amen.
All of us made mistakes. Yeah. But God's not looking at us that way. He's not judging us that way. He's not basing what he does for us based on what we do for him.
Amen.
He loved us before we even showed up.
Amen.
He loved. I don't know what you did. Last night, yesterday, a couple hours ago, that we would consider crazy. But guess what? God still loves you.
Amen.
He's not mad at you. He's not kicking you out like, oh my God, I don't know if I can do anything else with them. Because I'm loved, I can even come in here, raise my hands, open my mouth, and say, Jesus, thank you.
Yes.
Because I'm loved. But my point is, there's nothing I can do to stop God from loving. He loves me completely, totally. He's totally in.
Yes.
Totally in.
Yes.
And there's nothing I can do about it. He loves you no matter what you do. You can't do a thing about him loving you because what him loving you has nothing to do with what you do.
Amen.
Okay? Praise the Lord, man. All right. So, is that how many of y'all believe that?
Yes.
How many of you are like, I'm not really sure about that? Okay. Because you love and you understand you don't earn this. Jesus earned it.
Amen.
That's why we sing, Lord, I love you, Jesus. Why do you love me? Because you made it so I can come boldly to the throne and make my request known to God as if I died on the cross.
Amen. Wow.
All right. So, I know I talked about this before, but because I'm loved, I got to get this down. Some of y'all haven't been to church in a long time, but guess what? God loves you just as much as he loved me, and I come every Sunday, sometimes two or three times a Sunday. Yeah, I haven't had a joint in 36 years. I haven't had a drink. Tish, you funny. I talked to Tish the other day, and she said, sometimes you got to go. We used to go get a hook. I said, boy, I ain't heard that in a long time. How many of y'all remember that? The hook. Yeah. So I hadn't had a hook in 30-something years. But you might have had a hook a couple hours ago before you came. You know what a hook is? Okay, y'all. Oh, my God. Ms. Jackson, you don't know what a hook is? Okay, since we're friends, I'm going to tell you. You enlighten other people. No, that's alcohol. Then the Merry Christmas eggnog with a whole bunch of drink in it, a whole bunch of stuff to make you happy. We used to call them hooks in the military. Brother Freed know what a hook is. He'd get hooked all the time. I could tell by the way they... See, if you're still hooking. No, I mean, yeah. No. My point is, that does not affect God pushing his love towards you. Pushing his grace towards you. It does not affect. That doesn't affect anything that God is doing in your life, wants to do in your family, do in your future. It impacts nothing like that. Because God loves you independent of you. You can't do nothing to make God. You can't do nothing to make God stop loving you. God gonna love you. You can give him a sign and a wonder. He's still gonna love you. You can like God. I don't want you. He's still gonna love you. He can raise you from the dead. You're like, well, thank you. I'm going back to the party. I still gonna love you. God, like, ain't nothing you can do. Ain't nothing you can do to make me stop. Ain't nothing you can do. You gotta know that. Jesus, that's what Jesus came for.
Yes.
That's what people couldn't stand Jesus when he was on the earth. And he talked to them. There's nothing you can do about it. Nothing. God is good, man. If you don't know him today, I want you to get to know him. He's good. And he's not done with you. Man, he's God all by himself. So, Pastor, you said I can live any way I want to live? You can if you want to. And they're going to stop him from loving you. Oh, well, shoot. I probably need to come back here more often to hear this. Yeah. Well, I'm not done. Now, let me tell you what some of you heard that I didn't say. But I'm going to tell you what I said. What I said was, none of that will stop God from loving you. You can live like you want to. Drink a bit before you come to church. He'll still love you. Don't do that. Security have to carry you out of here. None of that affects God's love towards you. I'm talking about God's love towards you. I'm talking about God's love towards you. If you want to, do that. But it's not wise. Because it affects. If I don't, I need to read the Bible. I need to go to church. I need to hang around folk that love God. I need to be in an environment that's going to build me up, not tear me down. I need to do all of that. But it's not going to stop God's love from flowing to you if you don't do it. Amen. But it will stop your love from flowing to God. Yeah. Oh no, I love the Lord. Well, okay. But here's why it's so important. God's not trying to cramp you, your style. What God is saying is, don't do this. Why? Because there's consequences. Yes, sir. It's built in my law. There are consequences. And see, you can choose sin, but you can't choose the consequence. You can't choose the consequence. You don't know. I got a relative right now, laid up paralyzed, 25 years old because of the way he lived. And I can't say the devil did that. No. There's consequences to things. So God said, no, what you need to do is, see, the way you live doesn't impact my love towards you, but it impacts your love toward me. Ephesians 4 says, give no place to the devil. There's an adversary that wants to steal, kill, and what else? He wants to destroy your life. And so what happens is, if I don't read the word, then I won't find out how much God loves me. If I don't get in the Bible, I can't walk with God. What do you mean? I can't walk with him. How can two walk together except they be agreed? I can't walk with God. I think this is right. And God's like, no, I'm over here, but I'll never know it if I don't get in the book.
That's right.
I can't use the authority Jesus gave me. That stuff will come into your house, on your family. And God said, I gave you authority over all of it. My grace is sufficient. But if I don't get in the book, if I don't get around people know that, I will never, ever be able to do. I'll be like, God, why you don't do something? God's like, I gave you authority. Oh, you didn't read it? It will affect how I love God. God is always talking to me. God talking to some of you here tonight? Think, but Hebrews 3 says, your heart will be hardened. Sin, the deceitfulness of sin will harden your heart. God is always talking. He's always trying to show you the way of escape. He's always trying to show you instructions. He's always trying to show you, this is how you can fix this. But your heart won't be sensitive to him. Amen. It won't be sensitive to him. God loves you, but you can't hear him. So he said, that's why I need you to, that's why you need to leave that alone. And God said, he said, and he'll tell you, listen, this person here is, I know what they have, I know what it looks like, but I already know. I'm in your future waiting for you to catch up. If you'll acknowledge me in all your ways, I'll do what? I'll direct you. You may be going that way. God's like, oops. You may have to take a U-turn. But he'll direct, but when you're sensitive to him, he can show you those things. Amen. He'll show you how to prosper, and you don't even have to sweat. He'll show you. He'll show you how to navigate through situations and circumstances. But if I don't do what we call the right thing, I'll never be sensitive to him. I can't step into the peace of God. I can't step into the strength of God. When adversity comes, you ever wonder why some people can go through hell and keep smiling? And then some people, they fall apart like a Mexican Rolex. You had one? Well, you ain't been to Mexico. How many of y'all had a Mexican Rolex? Am I the only one? Okay. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. You go to Mexico. You got a Rolex. Hey, you want one? Oh man, Rolex and $5. And by the time you get home, you got green all on your wrist. But yeah. Yeah. Why is it some people? Because why is it some people can do that? Because some people can endure and other people can't. Why? So it behooves me. It behooves me to move toward God. Why? So I can love him. Amen. The Bible said, eyes have not seen, ears have not heard. Neither has it entered into the heart of man the things that God has prepared for them that love him. I'll never find out what God has prepared for me. I'll be wandering around trying to find something, and God has already prepared for me. But if I don't flow with him, I'll never know it. That's why you need to live what we call live right. Amen. And if you were here the last couple of weeks, we're talking about how God resists the proud. The proud is like, God, I know, but I'm doing this right here myself. And God like, okay, I love you, but go ahead. Remember he said in Ephesians, we'll be able to stand against the wiles and the schemes of the enemy. I won't be able to do that if I don't know him. He loved me enough to make provision for all of that. But that'll keep me from loving him. I said love is a two-way thing, right? Yes. So I wrote a couple of things. I'll miss his counsel. I'll miss his defense. I'll miss the peace. I'll miss the healing. I miss all of that. When I decide. Now, I'm going to close with this. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. I won't be able to draw on his love. I know there's times, you know, especially when I first started preaching, I'm like, oh man, I didn't have time to fast and pray for 2 days and minister and prepare myself to pray. But there's times when all you can do is draw on the love of God. That God's like, I'm doing the work anyway. I just need you available. Now you should pray because you need to keep your mind straight, but I need you right now to go do this. And that's time when you just draw on the love of God. You draw on it. You draw on it. And I can't even explain it, but you're like, wow, God, I didn't even deserve you doing this. Because he loves you, we get what we don't deserve. I said we get what we don't deserve, and we don't get what we do deserve. Yeah. And so that's why. Now, if you're here this morning and you were like, and you're like, Pastor, you know what? I'm not, no. I need to change. I need some things going in my life. I need this love, but I also need to get out of my situation. Well, that's what his love is all about. Whether you understand it or not, it's not about understanding. It's about God's power and his love. Now,
In Romans chapter 8, you don't have to turn there. He said, there's no condemnation to those who are in Christ. No condemnation. If you ever seen a condemned building, what they do, they say, this building is totally unfit to be inhabited. So we're going to tear it down. It's no longer fit. It's no longer useful. That's what the devil likes to tell people. You did this, you're unfit. You're an unfit mother. You're an unfit parent. This would not have happened if it wasn't for you. You. Now, don't get me wrong. We open doors, but it's not because I'm unfit. God says, my God, God is for me, and he redeemed my life from destruction. But the least little bit of mistake, the devil pounces on it and said, you're unfit, and you cannot recover from this. You did this. No, you're not usable. And God said, don't fall for that. Don't fall for that. Why? Because you're loved. All that's been taken care of. Because you're loved. All that's been taken care of. But here's the deal. In my closing moment, this is my second close. This is the last door. And I want to encourage you. I don't know how any other way to say it other than, man, let God love you. Quit playing with your life like you got this all together. Amen. You don't have it all together. None of us have it all together. And what God is offering you and offering me is relationship. He was the one who came up with this, you know, let's hang out thing in the garden. He told Adam and Eve, let's hang out in the cool. I don't do hot. I don't do cold. Let's do it. Let's do it in the evening when the sun goes down. But I want to encourage you that your life, your abundant life hinges on you responding to the love of God. It's just that simple. No, we're giving gifts to some people. We don't know y'all. Most of you, I don't know. And then by some people's standards, you don't even deserve it. But that's none of my business. We're obeying God. Now, you can go get some gas, you can go get some clothes, you can go get some a whole food, all that. You can dress your baby, get some diapers, all of that. You can even go get some booze. I hope you don't. Because that will contaminate the love, the gift. It won't contaminate God's love towards you because you got the gift. But the Bible says you don't want to frustrate the grace of God. But my point is, you don't deserve it. I don't deserve it. I don't deserve anything but hell. But because I responded to the love, now, man, I'm more than a conqueror. And that's what's going on. And that's what God is offering you this morning. This is what Christmas is all about. Thank God for all the gifts and all of that. But, man, at long after the 25th, thank you, Lord. I said long after the 25th. Is what I need. I'm going to a whole new year. I need all of this and then some. Amen. Praise God. Hallelujah. Amen. Let's pray. Let's pray. Let's believe God. Now, as I pray, I want you to think about something. This Christmas. I think that's a song too. But this Christmas, why don't you unwrap the gift of the love of God? Let me talk to the Christian first. I know what God has for you is so much better. Even, you know, for me, there's so much that God has freely made available. And all he's saying is, Come on up higher. Come on up higher. Let me have that place. Let me have that place where you're really valued. Let me have that place. I want to take you to that place. I want you to see what you're really made of. I want you to see what's really possible for you.
You don't have to stay at that place of dissatisfaction, unfulfillment. Thank you, Lord. For those of you that you feel like, God, this is, I'm just too bad. God doesn't care what you do, how long you've been doing it, where you've been doing it. What he cares about is right now, your decision. And if you think God is too busy and too upset with you, you are seriously wrong, because he said nothing can keep us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus. Nothing. If you're here this morning, I want to ask you to turn your life around. Don't allow yourself. Don't expose yourself. Don't open the door for the devil. Well, Pastor, it's not that bad. No, but the Bible tells us we open the door. We give him legal access, legal right to roam into my life and reap havoc. We want to stop that. We want to shut the door, kick him out, lock the door. It's over. But I'm talking to you this morning. If God's speaking to your heart, make a decision now. Turn and allow God to love you. Love you. Father, I pray for every person listening to me. You've done some awesome stuff today, and I pray that not one person leaves here without receiving the gift of righteousness. None of us have earned it. You just receive it. Just receive it. In the name of Jesus, I rebuke every spirit of deception. I rebuke it in the name of, you cannot confuse anybody any longer. The spirit that blinds minds, in the name of Jesus, I rebuke that. I cut that off in Jesus' name. Lord, thank you. All right, here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to pray. I'm going to give God opportunity to do a work in your heart. If you're here and you say, Pastor, I need to receive. Remember, you can't earn it. I need to receive the gift of being right with God. Jesus did it. I just need to receive it. If you're ready to turn your life around, I said, turn it around. This is where your power comes from. Thank you, Lord. If you need to reverse some things, man, thank you, Lord. Would you pray softly and let's. Yes, Lord, thank you. I hear the Lord saying, how long are you going to allow yourself to be put down and used? Wow. How long are you going to allow yourself? Look from where you've fallen. Look at where you are now versus where you were a while ago. God's not condemning you. He's just like, no, stop the descend and take it back up. You've already experienced it. Now just come on back. Just come on back. I don't know who he's talking to in here today, but if I were you, I would take that word. If you say, Pastor, I'm ready to turn my life around and get back on course. Thank you, Lord. The place where I need to be. I want you to take a bold step right now. I want you to send a signal to the enemy that the door is closing. The door is closing on you in the name of Jesus. And you're ready to step into that place of the grace of God, that where the unearned, undeserved power, favor, healing, joy, recovery, restoration. Hallelujah. I want you, if I'm talking to you, I want you to stand on your feet right now. If I'm talking to you, I'm going to pray in just a minute. I'm gonna lead you in a prayer. If you say, I've had enough already, enough, and you're ready to do something about it. Now, if you enjoy where you are, I'm not talking to you. Well, I am, but if you're ready to change, that's who I'm talking to. Stand right where you are, please. Thank you, Lord. Wow. I'm seeing some. Okay. Thank you, Lord. And stand up, please. Stand where you are. If you're ready. I'm believing that folks are ready to change the course of their life. Remember, preached several weeks ago, it's you. God is talking to you, but you execute. You pull the trigger. You cast the deciding vote. It's you. And God is waiting on you to choose him. Hallelujah. Come on, get your inheritance. Come on and get your inheritance. Come on and get your free gift. Come on and get what belongs to you. Get what you've been dreaming about. Get it. You are not disqualified. You are not unfit. It's a new day. It's a new day. It's a new day. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. Yes, shoot. Thank you. It's all good. It's all good. All right. Anybody else? Come on, stand with us, please. If you're ready. If you're ready. If you're ready. This is your time. I want you to stand up, please. Stand up. If there's anyone else. Okay. Now, let's all stand. Thank you, Jesus. Now, I don't want the people who stood initially. I want you to leave where you're standing, and I want you to come and stand up here where the ushers are, because I want to pray for you directly and personally, and then I want to lead you in a power move that will transform your life forever. Okay, is there anyone else? I want you to come. I know it can be hard sometimes, but I want you to, this is the reason I do this, is it takes courage to do this, and one of the things you're going to need in this journey is be able to push past that initial, what do people think? It takes courage. Thank y'all so much. It takes power to push past it. These people push past it. If there's anybody else, I want you to come now. You're going to push past it. I want you to push past it. You will not regret. Thank you, Father. All right, is there anyone else? You coming? Okay. Push past it. Push past that urge to remain. Now, when I do this, it's amazing. I'm not like making stuff up when I do this, but the Spirit of God is saying, there's somebody here, you used to be all in like this. And somehow, slowly but surely, moment by moment, just a little bit, you got off a little bit, and now you're in a place like, oh my God, how did I ever get there? And God is saying, that's why I brought you here today. Come on home. Come on home. Whoever you are, come on home. I don't know if you're standing here, but come on home. Jesus' name. Come on home. This is God saying, come on home. Come on home. I don't know who you are, but God is saying, come on home. It's time to come on home. Thank you, Jesus. Come on home. Yeah. Yeah, 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 yeah. Yeah. God is not angry. He's not mad. He's not holding anything out on you. My God, thank you. But we're about to open the floodgates in your life. Is there anyone else? I want you to come on and just push past that. Just push past that. Well, I'm just making a Christmas decision. Don't worry about that. Push past it.
God's mercy and goodness and mercy is following you today. I know some of you made a decision like, well, you know what, I'm done with all of that. I'm here, but I'm done with all that. No, God is talking to you. He's witnessing to you right now. He said, come on back. Come on home. Come on home. I'm not saying so much the church, but this church, but come on home to him. He wants